We want to thank the Institute of Architects Pakistan for giving us this opportunity of presenting our work that we've done for the past almost 15 years. It's almost scary to say that number. We didn't realize it had been so long till we started retracing our steps. And we realized that we're actually standing in between generations. My friend Faria has been trying to explain to me the various generations and where we sort of fall there. And I think we've been very lucky to have the generation which has been before us, and we've learned from them. And through our work and sharing our work, because I'm also, and rather both of us have been engaging in academics, to have the generation next. So we're kind of in between generations, and that sort of situates our work, as you will see. When we finished our, for me actually it goes back to my undergraduate days that I went to Daud College and we got introduced to the concept of socially responsive architecture and engaging with the society. And then when we set up our practice here in Karachi in 2000, we sort of didn't want to stay confined to a practice alone. We wanted to engage in research, engage with the city, engage with academic institutions. And we were very lucky that we were able to have all these opportunities here in this city. And so our work has kind of evolved out of this interaction and this relationship. The ingredients of the professional practice, of course, making of buildings is our trade and our basic training. But I think we've added and attached a few more attributes and values to it, which is essentially responding to the collective sort of societal issues as well, whether they be urban or academic or, you know, philosophical, academic. So we, through our work, we've been trying to work on those things with just by ourselves, but also with the various institutions and our students and our peers that we've been working with. So there has been a conscious effort to have collectives, to have engagements, to always try and have some research component to the work, and then also try to publish it, publicize it, advocate it. So that has been a very strong part, and I think we're kind of known for and one of the reasons I think we've been asked to come and speak. Stakeholders involvement, because we work with communities, we work with municipalities, work with academic institutions, students. So there's a wide array of stakeholders that we've been working and collaborating with. And in fact, the first project that I'm going to show is not a very conventional architectural project. It is centered around an architectural conservation renovation project. But there was a lot of diversity that came out of it, and I think it sort of personifies what we set out to do 10, 15 years ago, and I think that's the message for the generation next, the ones who are coming after us and the ones we are engaging and teaching, that it's a painstaking, long process, at times disappointing, at times elating, but eventually you do get moments or you do get projects where things sort of come together and you say, yeah, okay, that's what I sort of thought 15 years ago it could look like. So I'll quickly go to the project, but the diagram, I mean, that's very obvious. We've been engaging with various things at various levels, like most of us, but it has been a conscious effort, and that's the other message, you know, in times of recession or otherwise. There's not just one applicability to a architectural degree. One could be creative with it, and one could actually apply it in so many different ways. And now there's more and more room to do so. And there's more and more acceptability for this multidisciplinary kind of approach to having a first degree, which may be very pure applied in any certain field. So urban research and design, because that project kind of falls in that genre, is we've always looked at architecture as situated within a city and a city that's living. So our projects have always tried to engage in the sociological sense, in the cultural sense, and we've always tried to make some sense out of it. As you will see later in our projects, some of our projects are actually, they are dream projects in the sense that, you know, wow, how would it be if Karachi was pedestrianized? So, I mean, you know, it's like maybe a dream that will never come true, but we would like for people, and especially the younger generation, to believe in such things and at least try and attempt it at some level, be it in the studio. So there's a component where we spend a lot of time with our younger colleagues or our students developing these ideas, which we feel may, you know, may be applicable if not today, in another few decades. I'll give over the presentation to Christoph for this particular project, because this was the renovation of it. He started, and then I also got involved, and then it became like an art exhibition that we presented at the Mohatta Palace as the Rising Tide Contemporary Art exhibition last year. It ended in February this year. And we did a public participative project within that, in which our students, our colleagues, our various institutions that we've been working with, the city government, Sindh government, Mohatta Palace, NED University, all of those institutions and people were able to come together. And that was really the highlight of this project, I would say, and it was very well received, not only by the architect circle, but also the artist circle. So it was really they expanded the domain of art or contemporary art within that exhibition. It was curated by Naiza Khan, and I think she has a lot of foresight, and she included quite a bit of projects which are very new in Pakistan, but I think they will only grow in time. So I'll give it.
Yes, Assalamu Alaikum. So I'll give you a bit of background, further background on this project here. This is the Sindh Wildlife Building, which used to be the Freemasons' temple till 1970. In 1970, it got banned, Freemasonry got banned, so it became the Sindh Wildlife Department. So the interesting thing of this project is that it's a project which is still work in progress. We've started this project 4 years ago. It's a government project, so it takes its time. And Emily also has to have the patience dealing with the changes which happen all the time. But the interesting thing about this project was that there was no historic evidence available of how this building used to be. Maybe because due to the fact that it was a Freemasons lodge, so it was hidden away and destroyed, whatever. And so there was very little, there was not a single photograph that we found of how it used to be. So we had to start interview. I mean, of course, this project lasted for 4 years. So by then, I started knowing the Chaiwala, the Halimwala. I started knowing everybody around the site. So we started interviewing them. And that was actually part of this Rising Tide exhibition, that where we want to highlight the intangible of this project. That this project is not only about the building, but it's also and even more about the people who have been around this building for, some of them, 50 years. And actually one person who's been there for 100 years, his family has been there for 100 years, he was the superintendent of the Freemason, his father. So we started asking them, going from the Chief Mali to the Chief Jamadar to the Halimwala, how was this? Was this a pitched roof, or was this, which color was it? So they started giving us all information about how the building used to be. So this became very interesting, and we started documenting all this and represented this also at the Mohatta Palace. The biographies of all these people going from the Chaiwala up to the director of the Department of Antiquities. So all their biographies we put on the wall to put them on the same level, because for this project they had equal importance, basically. So these were some of the actors, some of the witnesses which were actually part of our team to develop this project. I know them all very well, but I won't start giving their biography right now. We don't have the time for that. But this was the Rising Tide exhibition. And where we presented some of these aspects. You see the photographs of all these people with the interviews and biographies that we added to it. And then the next phase, we didn't want to keep it at the Mohata Palace only. We wanted it to be a real event on the site with the actors that we've been dealing with for 4 years. So we involved the students of NED and Indus Valley to develop something free of cost, meaning free of cost with the materials on site. And the whole idea was to bring a space alive just by choreographing the existing actors on site. So we started, this is the site how it used to be, right next to the building. So some ideas came up where we started painting the shadows on the wall. I mean, it was a very, it was a really fun exercise. It was one of the assignments actually given to the students also, to do something with that site, bring some life to it with the material over there. And then we also had a presentation. The whole event started with a presentation at the city campus where various people made presentation about the history of Karachi. And then we brought this space alive by involving musicians, by planting trees, by letting people plant trees to involve, to give them a sense of ownership. Like a small anecdote, the Chaiwala, he's up to date after 2 months, he's still busy watering those plants. And he's still reprimanding students spitting pan on it. So, although it's not on the footpath, it's on the other side. So that's really what we want to achieve.
It's on my way to work, so I also stop every morning and every afternoon once in a while to, you know, kind of encourage, give a pep talk, say how nice, and they're actually flowering, so they're very happy. And this whole idea of this public space, where, because we didn't want only the building to be renovated, we wanted the space around to be active, because this is near the press club. And it's right in the center of the city. It's next to the PIIA building, and it's opposite to the PIIA booking office. There's a bus stop right outside. There are a few hawkers. It's in any case used by the students, but they're not allowed inside the space. They sit on the boundary wall. So for us, it was a moment where we wanted the building to become alive. And we wanted that public who only stands at the footpath and watches the building being renovated, we wanted them to come inside and engage. And eventually when the gardens around the building come up, and we've been talking to our client, and he's actually quite interested to develop it as a public space and a public garden, not only as something which would be locked up for the visitors to the museum. So this was like also an experiment and also a demo for the Department of Antiquities to see how that space could function as a public space. And I think that they're quite convinced. So let's see how it will go in the future.
So this is actually our latest project. And now let's start from the beginning. But let me see the time. 9 minutes. Okay. This was a project that we did together, although it was a master's that we did 12 years ago. This was a project in Morocco, where the main starting point was to look at a problem from a different angle. The main issue in Essaouira, which is close to Marrakech, was sewage water and choking of all the roads. We know that problem here also, here in Karachi. So what we did was we started recycling all that sewage water and started irrigating what we used to call linear forests, which would block the wind and which would block the dust for choking all the manholes. So that was a simple exercise, but the main idea here was to look at the problem from a different angle, which is very often forgotten. We tend to have a bias as architects that's a problem, it has to be removed. But sometimes you can just turn it around a little bit and it can become the solution. So that was an important lesson of this project. These are some projects that we did in Saudi Arabia. This was a horse racing track. We'll quickly go over it. This was an urban design exercise for the Orangi Nala and the Liag Express Highway, where again we started looking at the Nala not as a problem, but as a place that we can revive as an open space, which we are lacking in Karachi. I'll just show you a few images. You see the before and after. But okay, the whole aim of these projects was not to get it implemented, obviously. This was really a way for us to negotiate and explain, in this case, the site town office, the municipality. I think we succeeded, maybe 20%, to change their mind a little bit about what can be done with the Nala, because, of course, initially, the whole idea was just to commercialize the Nala. That was the main aim. So we were able to stop that.
This these slides we're showing also as I think as an example to show how the design studio itself, even in design in architectural schools, how they can be used and how it becomes grounds for developing these ideas, which can be used by the city, by the municipality. This was a collaborative project that we ran for 4 years at the Department of Architecture, NED, between 5 universities. So we had many designers, many architects, many students internationally working on these so-called problem areas of the city, but which we were encouraging each other and our students to look at as potentials and essentially as public spaces, which Karachi lacks. So Lyari, the Lyari bed, the Lyari River and its bed was looked at as a public urban space. And we all came up with various sectional details for it, even inclusive of the Lyari Expressway. So because the way it has been constructed, it's completely cut off the city into two. It's a huge wall that has been constructed. So we were looking at perforations. We were looking at architectural details. We were looking at the banks, and we were looking at the land use changes there and how in the future that will get adapted to a new social class and a new type of people who would go and live there, because the Kachiyabadis that existed are slowly moving out and it's being taken over by a middle class. So this was a kind of preemptive studio that we ran. And I think, and we shared the results with the municipality, we shared the results with the city, and hopefully they'll pick on, if not the designs themselves, at least the way of thinking or the way of approaching space. I think the other sort of landmark, the journey of looking at things and working with design at this level started with our undergrad, graduate projects. But there's something now at the Department of Architecture, NED, which is called Urban Research and Design Cell, which me and my colleagues formed some 4 or 5 years ago. And we are doing active research on urban issues. We are engaging in urban design projects. And I think that journey that started in 1997, it's kind of institutionalized now. So that, I think, is more like what this slide intends to say, that for design projects and for efforts to institutionalize at some level, that's important, and it's eventually, I think, beneficial for the society at large.
Yes, this was actually a project that we won with an IAP competition in 2006, which was for a neighborhood park in Azizabad, in Husseinabad. It never got implemented, unfortunately. But still, this also explains well what we're trying to tell you. This project, we really tried to look at existing problems again on the site. The site was surrounded by hawkers. And so the client was asking us to turn this into a ladies' park and remove all the hawkers. But then when we started interviewing those hawkers, we realized that all these hawkers, 95% of their clientele were women. So there was no need to remove them. They were already catering to the women. So we started basically encroaching on the surrounding streets of the park and started making into courtyards and try to redefine the boundary wall, because we really feel that having boundary walls around parks, it's such a shame, because you don't see what's behind the wall ever, and you also, and what was happening there, because there was a wall, there was a boundary wall around the park, it was basically a place where people would just dump their solid waste over the wall. So we started thinking differently, like for instance, we would incorporate the existing sugarcane voila into the wall. So you would offer sugarcane to people waiting for the bus outside, but also to the families inside. So we would there was also Goshtwala. He would use the wall would be used as part of his storage for storing his knives, basically. So we try to really make it a functional wall. Kudaki Basti, that was an incremental housing scheme that we did with Arif Hassan, where the whole concept was to, well, I can't go too much into the detail of this, but it's an incremental housing scheme in the sense that people, when they purchase a piece of land.
I think everybody knows the Kudaki Basti. It's an Akhan award-winning project. We did one of their Basti designs here in Karachi. And once again, we were looking at pedestrianizing, minimizing vehicular traffic, and trying to rationalize the public space. And it's been in existence now for almost 10, 15 years. It's, if you go to the next. Unfortunately, there was not much possibility of working on the architecture of it, which we would have liked to do, and we would have liked to go a step further into the design of low-cost housing, but it just kind of ended at the master plan. And people continued to use, well, we gave them the internal plans, but we couldn't, we should have actually pursued it a bit more, and we shouldn't have left it at that. But we couldn't give details of elevations, sections, and you know how to incrementally grow vertically, which they do in any case. But the house plans, some generic plans were developed, and people can go to the Saiban, which is the NGO running Kudak Bastis in Pakistan, and they can take those plans and make them. And they give them technical advice through the Rangi Pilot Project. But we basically were able to have a central pedestrian strip. We were able to give the idea of sewage recycling, urban farming. So, but I think the next thing to do, and definitely for any, you know, other attempts at low-cost housing, is to start looking into the architectural details and the low-cost technology itself and how that can be improved. Because in Pakistan, I don't think we have worked enough on that. I mean, just in our neighbors, neighboring countries, they've gone far ahead with this. So next. Some other housing schemes that we've done? Yeah, okay. Next. This was a research project we did with Arif Hassan. It was also published. This was a pedestrianization plan for Empress Market and Vines, essentially for environmental upgradation and accommodation of the hawkers, because the buses are inevitable in Sadr. You can't take them away. They're absolutely required unless we come up with another mass transit system. And so this was a study. It has not gone beyond that, although there was some dialogue with the city. These are projects, I mean, this of course is part of our work. We are architects, so we're engaging with adaptive reuse, conservation, building design. We started with urban design, but for the younger generation, this is not to give an idea that if you engage with the sort of middle scale or upper scale of architecture, which is urban, you don't do architecture. You absolutely do architecture. You have to bring all the scales together. And therefore, I mean, we do very essential basic architecture as well. We even do interiors. Not that many. I mean, it's not our sort of primary expertise. But yes, we do engage. We do continuous updating of knowledge on materials, details. Especially because we are teaching and we absolutely have to be hands-on with these things. So engaging with one scale of architecture doesn't mean that one gives up the other scales. So all scales can go hand in hand, but of course then you don't do like 100 architectural projects. You do fewer, you put in your time into other things which are probably more closer to your heart for whatever personal or professional reasons. And that's how you try and bring your practice together and try to have some commonality within. Next. Yeah, thank you.